I don't think there's going to be really necessarily a formal introduction, so I just thought I'd go ahead and get started. One of the things that I like to do when I talk about pandas is I like to get up on my soapbox and sort of, you know, become a salesman. And what I like to point out is that the Knoxville Zoo is actually the most successful breeder in the Western Hemisphere of red pandas. Uh-huh. So all these pictures that you see, like this picture right here, are pictures that I took at the Knoxville Zoo. So if you really want to see red pandas, go to the Knoxville Zoo and you get to see them. And I think actually at 3 o'clock, if I'm correct, Sarah Glass is coming from the Knoxville Zoo to give a talk. She is their curator of special exhibits, which includes, of course, red pandas. And she's actually a good friend of mine, and I've had some pretty funny interactions with her over the years. In fact, one of the stories that I love to tell is that when we first discovered the red panda at the Gray Fossil Site, I actually called the Knoxville Zoo, and I told them, I said, hey, I think we have a fossil red panda. And she said, oh, we're doing this little, you know, this workshop. You should come and talk to everybody. And all she told the people that were involved with this workshop is that some guy from the hills of East Tennessee thinks he found a fossil red panda. And at the time, I actually had, you know, the great big beard. And so I kind of walked in the door, and I could just see it in their faces like, there he is. Yeah, and needless to say, at first they were a little skeptical, but I went ahead and started giving sort of an impromptu talk, talking about the fossil red panda from Gray, and they realized, hey, this is actually something real. And they invited me to give a formal talk at one of their zoo conferences, which was kind of fun because I actually got to meet all these different people that work at zoos. And of course, if you're familiar with our program, we're constantly trying to get, you know, new specimens. I mean, we basically need a modern osteology, a modern skeletal collection. If you're going to study fossils, you need to have a good skeletal collection. And of course, you know, through that zoo connection, I met quite a few people and got some really neat stuff. But anyway, today when I talk about those, I want to sort of, you know, give you sort of an overview of pandas in general. One of the things that I definitely want you to take home as a sort of message is that these things are not in any way, shape, or form related to the giant panda. The giant panda is a bear. These things are basically more closely related to weasels, skunks, things like that. And so, of course, you know, I have to, you know, show you the picture of me holding a baby red panda, because I was fortunate enough to do so. And basically, what you have to think about is, what are these things? I mean, really, what are they related to? And what you have to do is you have to think about carnivores in general. And when you look at the whole group, carnivora, you know, basically the entire order of, you know, mammalian carnivores, there really are two main groups. You basically have, you know, the cat group, the Feliformia, which is basically cats and their relatives. Oddly enough, things like the hyena are actually more closely related to cats. They are in the cat group. And then, of course, you have the, quote, dog group, which is things like dogs, bears, seals. And then, of course, the little group that I'm interested in, the musteloids. And basically, these are true mustelids, true weasels, and all of their relatives. And included in that group is actually the red panda. And really, when you talk about red pandas, you know, when you think about red pandas, they really are sort of an odd, you know, leftover, if you want to say. They're literally the only member of their entire family. And there's a whole family, basically, that just has one single species. And literally, that species probably separated from other carnivores about 34 million years ago. So it's literally one of these things that sort of broke off and did its own thing. And that's kind of what I'm interested in. That's sort of what I want to study. So when you look at the red panda today, yes, he's cuddly. Yes, he's snuggly. They really are restricted to sort of the foothills of the Himalayas. Unfortunately, like a lot of mammals today, they are endangered. There's really not that many of them left. Actually, there's a black market trade of these things. They literally trade them as pets. I would not recommend one of these things as a pet. They have claws that are probably four times the size they should be for the size, you know, the mammal. They have these huge, ridiculous claws, and they're recurve, and they're semi-retractable like a cat. So I would definitely not recommend a red panda as a pet. But people do it. They whatever reason, they like to have them. I can't imagine one of these things crawling up your leg. It probably would not be fun. But, you know, again, today, foothills of the Himalayas. As far as size-wise, they're actually a fairly small mammal. The reason I threw this up here is I want you to recognize that there are actually two different subspecies. The Steini is actually the larger of the two, but what you're looking at is about 5 kilograms. It's pretty typical for these things, so pretty small. I mean, they're actually not very big. When you look at them, you think, oh, they're the size of a raccoon. No, not really. Actually, when you grab them, they're all fur. And that's the funny thing that I can say from experience is when I actually picked one of these things up, it was like, there's that, that's all hair. It's like this little mammal sitting in the middle of a giant pile of fur. Yeah, they really are cute. And again, like I said, look at those claws. But not when I have one of these. But anyway, as far as the fossil record goes, even though pandas are, you know, sort of restricted today, they're only found in the foothills of the Himalayas, as far as the fossil record, they were once very widely distributed. They were found throughout the Northern Hemisphere. They were actually a very abundant and very successful group. And so when you look at, don't worry about the details, but when you look at this sort of map, you can see all these little speckles all over the place. They were found throughout the Northern Hemisphere. I mean, literally, they were very common in Europe. They're very common in Russia. Oddly enough, they're not found in China, which I don't really understand. I think basically what you're looking at there is a lack of study. I think we just need to actually look for them. And in fact, right now we're planning a trip to China probably in May, and I'm hoping to poke around in some of the collections and see if they actually have some fossil red pandas. They probably do. They probably just haven't been studied. But again, they were once very widespread, and so I've often had people ask me, you know, why are red pandas, you know, doing so poorly today? And I say the really important question is, why were they so successful in the past? Why did they do so well in the past, yet so poorly today? And so I think really what you're looking at is, you know, we had a very different environment at that time, and they were very successful. So again, when you look at them, you really look at two main groups, you know, two main subfamilies. You basically have Simocyanae, which is sort of the larger representatives of the family, and then the Ailuridae, which is basically the true red pandas, and that's kind of what I'm studying. And this map actually shows just that subfamily. And one of the things I do want to highlight is when you think of the Simocyanae, the larger forms, when I say larger, I mean really large. The early red pandas were the size of a mountain lion, essentially, which is really cool. Basically, the living red panda is this tiny little representative of the entire family that is very small compared to its former, you know, taxa, if you want to say. And so literally what you're looking at is, you know, we want to focus on, you know, the family Ailuridae, which includes, you know, some of these larger forms, but also includes our little guy, Procynolurus. We'll talk about him in a minute. And then I say our little guy from Gray. But one of the things I do want to highlight is that, you know, we're going to focus on the subfamily. But notice the bears are up here. They're not too distantly related. We also have weasels and, of course, raccoons. They're all sort of closely related. This is actually a cool family tree that was put together by a buddy of mine, Manuel Salesa. He goes by Manolo. But what's kind of cool is when he first published this paper and he actually put our little red panda in it, I was kind of excited because I felt like, hey, they're actually recognizing our red panda. But he had hypothesized that ours would actually have the, quote, panda's thumb, the extra little, you know, modified sesamoid. It's basically a bone in your wrist that's been modified into an extra digit. He hypothesized that we would have that, and so it's kind of cool that, you know, he published this in 2006, and then when we actually found the skeleton, we recognized that ours does indeed actually have that. So this is actually an illustration of Simocyon. This is that primitive ancestral form of the red panda. It's the size of a mountain lion. And what he was showing was this modified bone, this radial sesamoid. And literally, what's kind of interesting is this is the giant panda, and it actually has a ridiculously modified radial sesamoid. It literally has 6 fingers, which is really, really cool. Yeah, it actually has an entirely extra digit. So when you look at the red panda and its relatives, like Simocyon, it's pretty small, but the giant panda is ridiculous. And I do want to highlight, this is a cool example of convergence. And if you're not familiar with the term, convergence is when you have two sort of distantly related animals that evolve similar features because they're under similar selective pressures. And so if you think about, you know, if they're hunting the same thing, if they're climbing the same way, if they're doing similar things, they'll often have a similar feature that will evolve. That's really, literally what we're looking at here. And actually, so Cymocyon, these are jaws of Cymocyon. It's a really cool animal because, again, it's about the size of a mountain lion. It has a huge second molar, which is very similar to the red panda. But again, it was a very big animal. And what Manolo sort of hypothesized is that this thing was moving up into the trees. That it was basically, even though it was huge like a mountain lion, it was climbing up in the trees. And so, of course, the question would be, well, why? Why would this thing bother and climb into the trees? And what's interestingly is that at that time, there were some ridiculous carnivores running around. Things like this. This is Macaropus giganteus. These things were actually running around at the same time. And so what Manolo hypothesized was that the red panda lineage sort of moved into the trees to get away from these guys. It basically, kind of like a leopard today, if you think about a leopard, it'll basically capture its prey and then it'll climb up into the trees and eat it up in the trees to get away from the larger things like lions or whatnot. I do want to highlight, I'm kind of mad at the artist for drawing it this way. There is no such thing as a saber-toothed tiger. You probably heard the term plenty of times. There's no such thing. Saber-toothed cats are a very sort of separate group from tigers and lions. So there's really no such thing as a saber-toothed tiger. I would just call them a saber-toothed cat. But I really get sort of mad at these artists because they always want to draw them kind of like a tiger. Which Sorry, I have to get on my soapbox once in a while. So when you look at sort of the distribution of these guys, you know, again, I said this is the modern distribution of red pandas, but in the past they were very widespread. I do want to highlight that this Japanese specimen is sort of in question. There are a few people that don't feel that it is a red panda, but the Russian specimen and all these European specimens that definitely are red pandas. And literally what you're looking at most of the time are just teeth. Isolated teeth, jaw fragments. I mean, this is one of those where when I get to the gray fossil site and I talk about our panda, you'll realize how lucky we are, because most of the time, this is what you get. Just an isolated tooth, a jaw fragment, something like that. I mean, they're common in Europe, but this is all they are. They're just little fragments, little bits and pieces. In North America, we have, of course, our specimen, which we'll talk about in a second, the gray fossil site. We also have a specimen from Washington, a single tooth that was discovered in Washington. And it's one of those things that when I actually looked at the specimen, I went out to the, it's actually, even though it was found in Washington, it's housed in the Los Angeles County Museum. When I went out to LA and I looked at the specimen, I dug through all of their collections. I was hoping to find more. I was hoping there'd be more there. But unfortunately, all I did was find more bear teeth for Blaine. For those of you that know Blaine, he was excited, but I was not. I was really hoping to find more, you know, more of this thing. But literally, that's all there is one tooth. So the gray fossil site is really, you know, a unique site in the fact that not only do we have, you know, multiple specimens, but we actually have, and we'll get to this in a second, but we actually have skeletons. We actually have, you know, fairly complete individuals. So originally I was, you know, thrilled to death. Larry Bristol was the one that actually found this tooth right here. This is an upper first molar. Don't worry about that. It's just, this is the tooth that we found first. I was, you know, excited about it because I recognized it was something different. I sent it off to a variety of people. In fact, that's really funny. Most of you probably don't know the story, but Blaine was actually not working here at the time. And I sent him a picture of this, and I said, what do you think this thing is? And he wrote me back, and he said, it looks like a, you know, a raccoon or something along those lines. And I said, yeah, I know that, but tell me, what do you think it actually is? And, you know, he was sort of excited about it, and he was sort of interested in the fossil locality, but it was with the little short-faced bears that I actually lured him in eventually. But he was one of the people that helped me identify this thing, or at least look at it. But early on, we just had a single tooth. You know, Xiaoming Wang and I were the ones that published on it in 2004. We were excited about it. We named a new species. You know, I tell everybody that, oh, I was confident it was a brand new species. But in reality, you know, in the back of my mind, I kept thinking, oh, I hope I didn't screw this up. But fortunately, a couple years later, we found an entire jaw of this guy, confirming that it was indeed a red panda, that it was indeed something new. And then, of course, as we started looking at the characters, we started recognizing that it really was a neat transitional form. I'm going to quiz all you guys on details, right? It had a neat sort of, you know, montage, if you want to say, of primitive and derived characters, and so I was really sort of excited about this thing. And, of course, later on, we found more specimens, and we even showed that, This angular process, don't worry about it, but the angular process is something that is very unique to red pandas, to have this gigantic angular process, and we did actually show that our specimen had that. It has to do with the feeding mechanisms, but again, not too important. But what was cool is this sort of first skeleton that we found, I was excited about it because it was significantly larger than a living red panda. So this white skeleton is a living red panda. The little pink skeleton here was our first skeleton that we found, showing you just how complete it was. And in fact, it's about 95% complete. It's a really complete skeleton. But it was about twice the size of a living red panda, which is pretty cool. And again, it's not entirely surprising when you look at, I showed you Simocyon earlier that I said it was the size of a mountain lion. It's not surprising that our fossil red panda is bigger than the living red panda. Because again, the living red panda is just sort of this end lineage. And this is just to show you how complete this thing really is. This is one of the forearms of that first skeleton. We actually have all the carpals, all of the wrist bones, including the radial sesamoid, including that quote panda's thumb. Sorry, these guys are just really cute. Just want to scratch them. This is actually the skull. Sean Hogrood and Brian Compton worked tirelessly on this thing, and basically we're able to piece together the entire skull. Beautiful skull. This is probably the best fossil red panda on the planet. As far as I know, most red pandas, again, like I said before, are only known from tooth fragments, jaw fragments, and so to have a skull and skeleton is ridiculous. This is a wonderful bragging right for the fossil site. And of course, we do even have the, quote, panda's thumb. And what I want to highlight here, don't worry about the little details on the side, what I want to highlight here is this is the, quote, panda's thumb from a, well, I say living red panda, obviously it's not alive, I've got bones here. Yeah, what's really sad is actually I've given this talk before for the zoo people, and they'll be like, oh, is that Sylvia? I always have to feel bad about that. The Knoxville Zoo is actually wonderful for providing us specimens, and they've given us a handful of modern red panda skeletons. Basically, they have a breeding population, but they also have individuals that are beyond breeding age that are just sort of living out their lives, and when they when they die, we get their skeletons. But anyway, what I want to highlight here is that we actually found, the quote panda's thumb. And what's cool about ours is it's smaller than a living red panda. Even though the animal itself is twice the size, the panda's thumb itself is smaller. And so I think what we're looking at is an animal that probably was not as active in the trees as the living red panda. So he wasn't, running around doing his thing like these guys. And of course, the question that a lot of people had is, how did this thing evolve? Was it evolved for climbing? Was it evolved for eating? The reality of it is, Manolo and, of course, Mauricio Anton and et al., they have suggested that it probably evolved in the red panda lineage for climbing, but once you have it, you can do whatever you want with it. Of course, once you have this extra little thumb, you can do whatever you want. So today, when you look at living red pandas, of course, they use it for grabbing and grasping as well, just like the giant panda. But it was probably originally evolved for climbing. And so again, we're probably looking at a really neat example of, again, convergence, where the giant panda and the red panda evolved a similar feature, probably for different reasons, but once you have it, you can do whatever you want with it. And so the giant panda uses it for grasping bamboo, the red panda uses it for climbing, but once you have it, of course, they're going to grab things. And again, notice those claws, ridiculous claws. So I think we really are looking at a cool example of convergence when you look at bears today, the living giant panda, and then of course our red pandas, they evolved a similar feature, just again, convergence. And what's actually sort of cool that something I'll mention here that has just come out in the literature recently, they've actually found a few other taxa now, a few other bears now that actually have that panda's thumb. And actually, this guy right here, don't worry about the name, Indarctos, they discovered a specimen of Indarctos from Spain that actually has the panda's thumb, which is pretty cool. Sorry, I have sort of a sick sense of humor. I can't help but throw these things up every now and then. So a couple of other cool things that we've noticed with ours. Originally, when I started looking at the limb elements of our red panda, the one I say ours, I mean the one from Gray, I noticed that it was quite a bit bulkier, even though this is the humerus, this is your upper arm bone, even though it's shorter than a living red panda, this is a humerus from a living red panda, this is our fossil, even though it's shorter, I noticed that it was bulkier, and so I did some calculations and actually recognized that it was probably, you know, pushing about 8 or 9 kilograms. Again, the living red panda, right around 5 kilograms, so, you know, probably just about twice the size. The other thing that I noticed is we had some weird things going on with the limbs in general. So this is a modern humerus. Notice that it's about the same size as the femur. The femur is your upper leg bone. But these two elements are actually from the same skeleton. And look at how long the femur is relative to the humerus. And so I noticed that there was something weird going on. So I started thinking maybe these things are doing something different in terms of locomotion. So basically what you have is a longer femur, but a shorter humerus. And so what are they doing? And early on, I actually had some students work on this. They started looking at taking measurements on all the different limb proportions and started playing around with some statistics. And what they actually came up with was that maybe ours, the little star being ours, is somewhere between arboreal, which is basically living in the trees, and scansorial, which is basically what a raccoon does, and kind of living both in the ground and the trees. And then maybe that it was somewhere in between. What's interesting is that I have another student, another graduate student, who started playing around with this, and actually he's coming up with results that show that it is falling in the arboreal. So I really have to figure out what's going on with this guy. I mean, is our fossil red panda, you know, the one from Gray, is it living in the trees? Is it living on the ground? What is it doing? And I think it's actually a more complicated question than I originally thought. So we'll see where that goes. And of course, you know, looking at multiple specimens, you know, I originally noticed the proportional differences and thought, okay, maybe they're doing something lifestyle different. But the other thing that I noticed is that we actually have some size differences. And early on, I was thinking, well, maybe they're sexually dimorphic. You know, maybe the males are bigger, maybe the females are bigger, who knows? Maybe something's going on. And we actually had two nice jaws that showed some differences. If you look at this jaw below, it's quite a bit bulkier. It has a much larger canine. And I thought, well, maybe they're actually sexually dimorphic. Well, what's interesting is that living red pandas, this is a male and a female right here. This is a male and this is a female. Living red pandas are not sexually dimorphic. They're basically the same size. They look, you know, the same weight. There's really no differences between them. And so these early ideas that maybe ours was different was kind of interesting. I really wanted to kind of look into this. And actually, I've got a student, I don't know if you guys are familiar with Ethan. He's one of our students. He's actually from the University of Tennessee at Knoxville. He's been volunteering as well as working for us out at the fossil site. And he actually went to the Smithsonian and measured a whole bunch of skulls of living red pandas and did actually find a sexually dimorphic character. And turns out the canines are sexually dimorphic in living red pandas. So he actually found a cool character. Now with us, of course, we were lucky. For those of you that have been sort of following our, you know, excavations, a year ago we were fortunate and we actually hit another skeleton. This is actually people working on that other skeleton. Sean all fired up about it. Yeah, this was a wonderful specimen that actually came in a big jacket. It had a couple boulders in the jacket itself, but it turned out to be a really nice skeleton. It's hard to make out here, but what you're actually looking at are, if you can see a radius and ulna here, a radius and ulna here. Here's actually the jaws, the base of the skull itself. So literally we found a nice articulated skeleton of another individual, and it turned out to be really, really large. It's actually significantly larger than the first skeleton. This is a beautiful skull. And literally what we found is that if this is the living red panda right here, you know, for size, our first skeleton was about twice the size. This new skeleton was about 3 times the size. So it's really, really large and fairly complete. If you look, this one's about 95% complete. This one's about 75% complete. Even though, you know, you look at the ribs, you say, hey, there's no ribs. This particular individual, we found a lot of the heads of the ribs. This one, we're missing most of one of the limbs and most of the tail. But again, very complete skeleton. You know, absolutely wonderful preservation. I was thrilled to death. And I, you know, one of those whole publisher Paris things, I've got to get busy on describing these skeletons because they're just absolutely gorgeous. to show you sort of size-wise. What's really cool with this is an old picture. In the meantime, they've actually found the missing teeth. They turned up in some of the screening. If you're familiar with the Gray site, which many of you are, we actually screen all of our sediments. We're one of the few sites that screens everything. And so literally when you dig around a skeleton, we bag that sediment and we screen it. And so even though it's missing a few teeth right here, they did turn up in the screens. I forget, Sean, were those in the bag sediment or the...
They were in the bags that Wayne got. They were from the pit.
Yeah. So literally those teeth turned up. Wonderful skull. One of the things that you can note is obviously it's bigger, but notice the muzzle area. It's a very robust muzzle. Again, that's very typical of musteloids, is to actually have sexual dimorphism. So even though the living red panda shows only a slight amount of sexual dimorphism, clearly ours shows quite a bit. And one of the cool things, I don't think I mentioned this, but I'll mention it now, is that Ethan actually submitted a paper just recently describing the sexual dimorphism that he found in the canines of living red pandas, but also looking at the sexual dimorphism in our specimens. And one of the things that he found was that if you take a normally distributed population and you just randomly sample two individuals, what are the odds of finding two individuals so different in size? And he found that it was actually less than 5%. So literally, this probably is, again, males and females. We can't prove it for sure if... for those of you that are familiar with anatomy, if we had found a baculum with this particular skeleton, we could have shown for sure that it was a male. We didn't find that, but I crossed my fingers and we'll find it eventually. Again, this one's showing the size difference. Modern red panda, the first skeleton, the second skeleton, again, so much more massive. Yeah, just ridiculous how much more massive the second skeleton is. And so, of course, some of the trends that we see, some of the things that I like to sort of highlight is that even though, our panda is showing some really cool different things in terms of the panda lineage, one of the things that I like to highlight is that the Washington specimen is quite separated. These are the European and the Russian forms right here in the middle. This is the Washington specimen up here. So it's quite separated from ours. So even though, our red panda is cool, our red panda shows some neat characteristics, it's very primitive compared to the Washington specimen. So it looks like you probably had two separate immigration events. So if you think about where Russia, Siberia, and Alaska sort of come together, the Beringia, that area where you have a land bridge, we probably had multiple pulses. We probably had a pulse with ours coming over and then a pulse with the Washington specimen coming over. So even though they're both in North America, they're distantly related, which is kind of cool. The other thing that I like to highlight is that even though ours has the, quote, panda's thumb, it was probably using it less frequently. It was probably spending more time on the ground than the living red panda. I don't know why I took this picture. I just thought it was funny that he's munching on the, munching on the plants there. Again, all these pictures are from Knoxville. I had way too much fun taking pictures of these pandas in Knoxville. So again, even though ours has the panda's thumb, it was probably spending less time in the trees than the living red panda. And that's not entirely surprising considering the dentition. I didn't really talk about it earlier, but the dentition of our fossil red panda, the one from Gray, is very intermediate. It actually has, sort of the grinding molars like the living red panda, but it has slicing premolars. It actually still has, teeth that can be used for meat, if you want to say, actually grabbing meat. Yeah, and I don't know why, I just thought this picture was really funny. What was really entertaining, if you guys could have been there, was that when they gassed out, they actually gassed out this red panda so they could do this. When they gassed it out, they didn't quite do it enough. And so the vet was holding on to the panda, and all of a sudden I saw him just kind of firming up. And I thought, what's going on? And basically the panda was waking up. And so he was kind of fighting it for a little while. They had to re-gas it, which was really entertaining. But yeah, I snapped this picture. I just couldn't help it. But again, our fossil red panda, the one from Gray, actually has a nice intermediate dentition. It actually has slicing teeth as well as grinding teeth. So it probably was sort of intermediate between the living red panda. And the little sketches here, if you've walked through the museum and you've seen all the wonderful artwork we have in the museum, Karen Carr did all the artwork for the museum, and these were some of her early sketches of the panda. I got to work with her basically day in, day out for quite a long time as she did all of her artwork. And basically, you know, she would do these little pencil drawings, but her final work was actually all done on the computer, believe it or not. All the artwork that you see in the museum was done on the computer. There's no original paintings, there's no nothing. It was done on the computer. And it was done to scale so that she could literally print it out. And the way they printed it out was they printed it on wallpaper. So when you go through the museum and you see all the illustrations, it was printed on wallpaper, which is pretty cool. But these pencil drawings were some of her original sketches that I just thought were cool. So literally, when you think about it, again, you know, it does sort of support this idea of two separate immigrations. But I think the big sort of take-home message is that even though pandas originally sort of, you know, worked their way into the trees, when you look at, you know, the Simoscion and some of these things that worked their ways into the trees, getting away from big carnivores, I think that Celeste et al. Were, you know, correct in that. But I think when it comes to our panda, when it comes to the gray fossil site panda, I think that it was doing something a little different. I think it was coming down out of the trees. I think it was a bit more like a raccoon today. So when you think of the red panda from the gray fossil site, even though it's not, you know, super closely related to a raccoon, think of that as a lifestyle. I think that's what it was doing. I think that it was coming down out of the trees. It was spending more time on the ground. And it was sort of living the raccoon lifestyle. It's unfortunate that once raccoons, of course, actually came into North America from South America, they probably outcompeted the pandas. So that's probably why the pandas are gone today, is that the raccoons were better at being the raccoon than the red pandas were. I know that sounds weird, but it's kind of where we're going. Aren't they cuddly? Alrighty, with that, I will open it up to questions. Does anybody have questions?
Can they be also related to the red fox?
What's that?
The red fox. Are they related in any way?
Not really. The red fox is basically, you know, a canid's dog. And so, in a sense, they're in that same sort of dog group. But no, they're just related. They're actually a variety of quote, canids that actually have that red form. If you think about it, not only the red fox, but even the gray fox actually has red on it. So, yes, I have a question. Sure.
Are the red pandas being raised in captivity to release into the wild?
They're trying to do it a little bit in China, but I don't know how successful they have been, but I do know that they are actually breeding them and trying to release them. Here in the United States, we actually have a good breeding program, but they're unfortunately all in zoos and things like that. You know, the sort of, you know, the little statement that I like to say that I think it's just Charles was here in great. The life expectancy, the oldest known panda that I'm aware of was one that we received, and she lived to be 19. So that's unusual. I think more typical is the, you know, 12 to 14 range, but 19 is the oldest that I'm aware of.
Do they have litters?
What's that?
Do they have litters, multiple?
Yes, they have litters. They'll often have two or three individuals when they actually have births. And that's the kind of cool thing. If you go to Knoxville, you know, every spring they'll have a couple individuals, little babies running around. And again, these pictures are from, you know, Knoxville. And what's funny is they refer to them as popcorn because when they're first born, they're really docile. But once they get to about that size, they just roll around and do all kinds of cool stuff. And so they say they're like popcorn. Go ahead.
You mentioned that the process that was on one of those jaws had to do with diet. What type of diet would the animal have been eating that resulted in
The big angular process, right, is from eating the vegetation because they have to chew it so much. You know, they really have to chew and chew and chew and chew and chew and chew. And really what it's from is the fact that you're looking at a, quote, carnivore that has evolved to be an herbivore. And so they actually have to modify their jaw to do so. And so, yeah, that was the kind of cool thing is that, you know, when the first jaw that we found, it was broken off, but it looked like there was a big base. And so I thought, oh, you know, surely there is one there. And so we found the next specimen it actually had, and it was really kind of cool to see it. So in reality, you know, they really are an omnivore. I mean, they were eating a little bit of everything, which is kind of cool.
Where are you going to study in China?
We're going to go to the IVPP. It's their main institution for paleontology. And I'm going to start there, but I've also, my co-author, Xiaoming Wang, I've written him and said, hey, where do I need to go? Because he sort of knows the collections, and so I need to figure out where might there be pandas. Because a lot of the people that I've talked to have said there are fossil red pandas there, they're just not described. Unfortunately, one of the things with China right now is that, I'm trying to think of how to say this politely, but they're 100 years behind us when it comes to, you know, paleontology. And so literally, if you think of us 100 years ago, we were going after big stuff. We were going after dinosaurs and the cool things. And it's only now that we've started looking at the little things. Well, they're still in that phase where they're going after the big cool stuff. So you see all these new dinosaurs coming out of China. They're not studying the little things yet. And so I just need to get there and see what's been collected but not described. I mean, that's why when you watch, you know, the Discovery Channel, things like that, that's why there's all those cool things coming out of South America, coming out of China, because they're just now getting into that phase. It's just the way it works. I mean, we've literally been studying, you know, fossils here since the time of Thomas Jefferson. I mean, he described some of the first fossils from Saltville, Virginia. So, I mean, literally, we've been doing it for a long time.
Is the panda that we have here, Gray, is it unique to this site?
As far as I know, we have not found it anywhere else. I was really hopeful when I first described it that I would get, you know, emails from people saying, hey, I think we have it here. Hey, I think we have it there. It has not turned up anywhere else. And I've really been looking hard. I mean, particularly in Florida. We have a lot of things here that are also found in Florida. So I've really been looking there. But so far, it has not turned up anywhere else. So it really is endemic to this area. My guess is when you think of the Gray Fossil Site, it kind of is its own little island. I mean, it's recording what's going on in the eastern deciduous forest at that time, and we don't have any other localities nearby. And so I think that it probably is endemic to this area, but until we find another locality close, we probably won't find any more. Don't get me wrong, I really want to.
Does the coloration change as they mature? The babies are white.
They vary tremendously, and it doesn't really change throughout the life. I should highlight the Steyni when I talked about the two different subspecies. The Steyni is much darker. It typically has a lot more black on it. Fulgens, typically is a bit lighter, but it really does vary between individuals. So it's not like this guy's going to get darker as he gets older. He'll maintain his color.
Yeah, because your initial photo had one that looked almost white.
They often have a lot of white in their face, but they're very dark underneath, and then you usually have the red on top. What's interesting is, you know, I mentioned the name is Ailurus fulgens. What's funny is Ailurus actually means cat, but fulgens means fire, so it's the fire cat. So, yeah, it's based on the coloration.
And what would be the advantage of being red?
Believe it or not, it's great camouflage. It's one of those things that I always find fascinating is when you look at a tiger and you think, why would you be bright orange with stripes? You put a tiger in the shadows and they disappear. I mean, that is a really good camouflage. It's actually a fantastic camouflage for heavy vegetation. And one of my neatest little, if you want to have some fun, get on YouTube, look up tiger attacks. And there's a fabulous piece of footage of a tiger that's in the grass. And there's a guy sitting on top of an elephant. And this tiger just leaps out of the grass and literally leaps, you know, goes after the guy, of course, ignores the elephant. But what's really neat to me is that you don't see it. It's in the grass, and you don't see it until it jumps out. I mean, they really do blend in well. So that orange color, oddly enough, is fabulous camouflage.
Is it orange?
Sure.
So the thinking is that our panda immigrated across the land bridge, and it actually originated in Asia.
Probably originated in Asia. You know, one of the things that occasionally people will say, we have the oldest red panda. We really don't. There's actually an older specimen from Spain. It's about 10 million years old. It looks like it's a fossil red panda. It was originally only known from a couple of teeth, but they've actually found a skull recently. They haven't described it yet, but it is out there. It's one of those things that I kind of know of, but they haven't published yet. But it looks like probably the whole, quote, panda evolution took place in either Europe or at least in Asia, and then there were multiple immigration events over to the New World. And again, the Washington specimen is a really derived, really advanced panda compared to ours. So probably two separate events.
Yes.
people that's interested in Wally, if they go, if they Google Knoxville Zoo Panda Cam, they actually have a panda cam on the new, two new babies and the mother that's still.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Actually, I haven't looked at that.
It's ghostly because they don't have the lights on. Yeah.
Okay.
It's a ghostly looking thing. Everything is white and gray.
Did you see some things running around?
Yes. Well, they don't run around too much. They're hiding in the little cat carriers. You'll see a head stick out occasionally.
Okay. Well, yeah, definitely. If you get the opportunity, go to the Knoxville Zoo. I mean, obviously, it's they really have a nice display. And one of the things I hate to say is that they teased us ridiculously recently. They had offered us a red panda. They had said that we could have one here. If we set up an environment for them, they would give us one. Because what they have is they have a breeding population, and if an individual is successful at breeding, you know, year after year after year, its genes become too common. And so they literally score these individuals every year as to whether they should be breeding or not. Well, what they get is sort of a retired group, a group that's been successful, and they kind of put them behind the scenes, and they just sort of live out their life as a red panda. But anyway, they offered us some of these individuals, and I was so excited about it. But apparently recently, their status has been upgraded or downgraded, however you want to say it, to even more endangered. And so now they are actually not allowing zoos to do that anymore. So they teased us. They kind of held a little carrot out and teased us, but apparently we're not going to get a panda. I'm still going to try. Don't get me wrong. I'm still going to try to get one here. I'd love to have one of these little guys here. Anyway, another question?
Now, the original picture showed him chewing on cane, bamboo. Do they have...
Living red pandas today eat primarily bamboo. But one of the things that I found out was in talking to the zookeepers, they'll eat anything they can catch. So if a mouse runs through, if a bird flies through, and they can catch it, they'll eat it. So even though they are, you know, on paper, they're listed as an herbivore, that they eat only bamboo, they will eat other things. And so again, when you think about our panda from Gray, with a different dentition, it probably was literally eating whatever it could grab.